Okay. So finally. How was your presentation today?
Good.
Yeah. And the people came from Bhopal? And what was the conversation about?
It was about, these are the people working with government, NGOs, and research scholars, some police officers, some bureaucrats, some law graduates who want to learn about sustainable development, renewable energy, and organic farming, biodiversity, and sustainable living style.
How come a social worker is so closely tied to sustainability?
Because this is the first responsibility of a social worker, to think about society. And society is not just the people. Society is the human beings, human kingdom, animal kingdom, and vegetation, and other resources we have, like the mineral kingdom, and then about the five elements. So because society is not just people, so how people can live in harmony with all the other beings, like animal kingdom and vegetation and five elements, that only can sustain the development. And sustainable development means that people make sustainable choices in favor of these kingdom and these five elements, so that the development can be sustained forever.
Do you think the ecosystem that people live in decides a lot of their socioeconomic status, mental health, etc.?
Yeah, it's not ecosystem only. Ecosystems are there. But people have to decide and make choices how they keep conserving and protecting and developing the ecosystems in a way that that will continue forever.
How do you think that's currently happening? Because I saw that you had amazing results with the Barley Institute.
Mm-hmm.
I think most of your merit comes from those amazing numbers. I think that it's very exceptional how you actually educated a big cohort of women and mm-hmm. other people.
Yeah, because women are the natural agents of sustainable development. They have a womb. They are the first educators of humanity. And if they make a choice, if they are empowered, then the generations will be empowered. So they are the natural agents of sustainable development. And sustainable development is sustaining the relations with the Creator and all His creations. And sustainability starts first with the man and the woman. Humanity is a bird, and man and woman are two wings of humanity. And first harmony starts with man and woman when they work together and they think and they plan what kind of family we should have, what should we eat, how we should live, what kind of resources we should use, and what should we contribute as individual. How I will contribute to my own sustainability and the sustainability of the family and sustainability of the community and environment, and think globally and act locally.
If you would like introduce yourself as simple as possible, how would you like to be known?
My name is Janak Palta-McGilligan. I am Palta is the surname of my father. I am a descendant of Guru Nanak's sister, Bibi Nanki's family from Punjab. I am brought up in Chandigarh. I was born in Jalandhar, and I am raised by a family in a very empowered manner. And I have been given opportunities to grow and make choices. And I was very inquisitive as a child, and I was always very investigative and very sensitive. So at the age of 15, one time I just had to undergo an open heart surgery. I was hospitalized for 1 year, and when that was the first successful open heart surgery, when I became conscious, the doctor told me, "You have made the history. Look, your surgery is successful." And before he could complete his sentence, I had not opened my eyes yet when I said to God, "You have given me new life. I will spend this life thanking you because you have given me human life." And then I started thinking about life, God, and how to thank him. And I started doing a little bit of teaching the children who could not go to school. I started helping the blinds who could not read and write. I started as a successful showcase for people who wanted to go for open heart surgery. I was invited to sit in the OPD, and the doctors will tell the people, "Here, talk to this girl." Because that was not a time of Google, when people could Google and see, okay, this is the successful. There was no YouTube. So I had to go and sit in the OPD, and the doctors would tell, "Look, this is a successful surgery." And people will accept, and they'll go in for successful surgery. And then the successful surgery started. In my life, I did not just regain consciousness out of anesthesia. I regained consciousness. I actually gained consciousness about the purpose of my life. And I started investigating purpose of my life and how, what path I should follow. Ultimately, after 16 years, I found Baha'i faith, the path. I made a choice to follow Baha'i faith, and there it made me a clear, it gave me a clear direction, and I started following it. And I never went to college or university, but I did a lot of my studies, degrees, masters in English, political science, music, MPhil, PhD, and I also did many jobs in government department as a translator in High Court. I was a lecturer in a college, then I was a research fellow. And I was a research fellow in a research center where I was working for the research projects by Ministry of Home, Government of India. And I had come to Indore to study Hindu-Muslim violence as a government official, as a official. And there I saw a piece of land and Baha'i community. I met the people and I asked them, "What is this big piece of land for?" They said, "We are waiting for somebody like you to come and start the training of rural and tribal women." So this was a 6-acre piece of land and nothing around it, no wall. So I left my job, I left my family, parents, and I moved to Indore. I started the institute in 1985 called Burley Development Institute for Rural Women. I started alone, and I was able to go and help 302 villages which were affected by guinea worms. So, yeah. So those were eradicated from 302 villages, and then I was invited to Earth Summit to receive Global 500 Award by UNEP for my institute. But attending the Earth Summit was the opportunity, and it was opening my eyes and my horizon that now I am a Baha'i and I am talking about Earth is one country and mankind its citizen. And one planet, one people. Now environmental issue is no more only for my village, India, Indore, Jabua. So I started thinking about everything. After 3 years of my coming here, Jimmy came in my life, Jimmy McGilligan, was another Baha'i from Northern Ireland. We both got married, and he just took over all my work relating to campus development, sustainable development. We started building that campus with the growing of organic food, making a solar kitchen, training the girls in a holistic manner with literacy, health, environment, skills, and learning to develop myself and my community to make them empowered. They become empowered to go back and serve their communities while becoming entrepreneurs or getting good jobs in their own communities. And they took 500 solar cookers in their villages, and the women said, solar cookers have saved my dignity, because they were very vulnerable to rape and sexual abuse as they had to walk long distances. They were now free from smoke. Jimmy used to say, cooking in smoky kitchens is violence against women. So they were smoke free, they were hazard free, and a lot of miscarriages were taking place when they were carrying big load of wood. So also they started using cooker for their personal use and their domestic use, and making livelihood, making snacks and selling, making food for children, midday meal for schools, and it changed their life. And in fact, they changed our lives, Jimmy and me both. And Jimmy made the first solar kitchen in central India at Burley. That was the beginning of our direct involvement, because he started organic farming,
but
and we lived waste-free life.
How did he come up with the solar cooking? Like, how did that enter his life?
It just happened because this Professor Sani and ministry wanted to test some solar dish, and he tested it and he proved that it is very good. And then there are all lot of datas he generated, comparison he did between LPG cooking, direct cooking with wood, and solar. So, but then soon we realized, I got cancer in 2007, and we realized that I must prepare somebody to take over the institute and successors. So we trained the successors. We left the institute in 2011. And we decided to come to this village, Sanavadiya, where we made this house. And first thing Jimmy did was we made a solar and wind power station for the community of 50 landless laborers. And we generated funds and collected things to build a community center to teach the local children free of cost with the help of government. And children were coming to our house. And then we also started growing food here. Unfortunately, Jimmy and I met with an accident. Jimmy died after 17 days in 2011. After that, I came here and started living with one of my girls trained at the institute, she and her family. So we started living here. We created half an acre biodiversity farm, and we have made a solar kitchen. We have 13 models of solar cooker. We have been training people free of cost, and I have trained more than 65,000 people in last 6.5 years, and I'm supplying free electric power, solar and wind power, 19 street lights to the neighborhood in my village. And we are fully self-sufficient in food by growing our own organic food, except salt, tea leaves, cooking oil and sugar. And then we don't generate waste. I do not use any plastic, and my gas bottle is consumed 2 years and 4.5 months. And I am having a local cow and a dog, and we all eat organically grown solar cooked food. And in this process, I have met many young people, and I have been also instrumental and co-founder in making a open area, a farm where farmers could sell their organic food. And now many people have started organic food, and it's called Jaivik Setu, and people are selling there. So I am also practicing sustainable lifestyle and training people in making natural colors for Holi, and I am training people on my birthday on launching cooker. My husband's death anniversary 1 week is celebrated giving solar training, solar cooking, solar baking, solar deep frying, making organic insecticides and pesticides and soil treatment, nutrition for the soil. And I'm addressing many institutions, and I am on the boards of many institutions, and more than 100 institutions have come to my institute, and government has sending people, officers to come and learn. Farmers come here, women come here, microcredit groups come here, women learn solar cooking from me, and the young people are getting involved in doing organic farming.
Yeah, so you got to inspire many of the people that I've met. How did that go exactly?
It's just because my house is open for everybody. So, and I am free, and I am accessible. There is no doorbell in my house, and people know. And I have been here in this city for 34 years, and I am known as Didi. So I'm like a mother or a friend, and people find it very comfortable to come to me. And also I'm always trying to meet such people, and people bring the people. Now for the last few years I'm very active on social media. I'm on Facebook. So and I'm not on Facebook just changing my profile photo. I write regularly what I did today, and then those people who are interested in it, I have a little page on Facebook, and I also Twitter. And very frequently when I organize things, I'm mostly in the news, in the newspapers and the TV channels. So people find me and I find people. And I think being a social worker, my first concern and my first foremost duty is to be working for society. So all these people who say they are inspired by me, because they are my society, and also I see them as youths who will continue the sustainable development work after I leave this world physically. And I have been promoting planting trees on Raksha Bandhan. I am promoting trees on birthdays and honoring people. And now recently I became 70 years. On my birthday I planted 70 trees. So I don't remember, but maybe I have been instrumental in planting more than 10,000 trees by now. And if I have to attend a marriage, I have to see a newborn baby, I always take a plant. And somebody's birthday, or even when people die in their memory, I go and plant a tree. And I think we don't have a choice, because I survived the road accident also in 2011 when my husband died. And since then I think we don't have a choice how we will die, but we have a choice how to live. So I'm trying to live thanking God and trying to be harmonious with people, and I am always available and I love people.
How did you cope with the death of Jimmy?
It's been very difficult, but because Jimmy physically departed. I believe in his soul, and I believe what would make him very happy also. And I am trying to continue all the work that we thought we will do together, but it's very hard I'm always with people, and people are always with me. I'm never alone, but I'm very lonely without Jimmy. But I know I will meet him soon, whenever I also go there and meet him there, up there. And as long as I live, he's living in me.
Yeah, because you speak about him as if he's here.
Yeah,
he's here. Which I think is really beautiful. Because
he's here. He's here. Every day people come and they say, my work is known as Jimmy McGilligan Center for Sustainable Development, which doesn't solicit funds. I don't take any money from anybody. I don't take any fees. So it's all my service. Whatever I can do with my body, mind and soul, I try to do it, but I'm able to do it because I am Jimmy's wife. He was Order of British Empire awardee by the Queen Elizabeth in 2008 for his services, social cause, and promoting alternative sources of energy in rural communities of India. And I have been awarded by MP government, Madhya Pradesh Gaurav Samman, Social Worker Samman. I have been awarded Green Hero. I have been ordered by Solar Cooker International as Order of Excellence. And my Government of India has honored me with Padma Shri Award, and which I have not worked for awards. But I humbly accept and appreciate. But I also think that these awards and honors give more responsibility, and I'm also consciously trying to live to that image, that I am a person for sustainable development. But I think I'm only able to do this by sustaining relationship with the people, sustaining relationship with my community here in the village, sustaining relations with my parental family, sustaining relation with people in Northern Ireland, and main is sustaining relation with God, with my prayers and trying to follow Baha'i faith. So
how was it to visit Jimmy 2 days ago?
It's always very heartening for me when I'm there. I know it's his remains and it's his resting place, but I go there and I take pride that a man born and brought up in Northern Ireland is resting here. He came to serve my country, and he died here, and he's buried here in Mother India's soil. And his grave says he served the country, served the Berlin Institute, and I am his wife. And I get a lot of strength from him anyway. Okay? I need to say goodbye to these people.
8 minutes. What would you... What would you tell people that the main ingredient was for you to actually have such a social impact with the Berlin Institute? Because to be really honest, from all of the grassroots innovators, all of the people that I've researched and met, you're definitely one of the few that really had all the ingredients to thrive in such a complex society and ecosystem as India.
Mm-hmm.
You actually overcame things that other people were not able to overcome in order to reach those people to actually become emancipated.
Mm-hmm.
What would you tell younger generations or people in your field?
Mm-hmm.
What is required?
I think first thing is required is the pure motives. Motives should be pure, and we should not be funding driven. We should be focused. We should be in learning mode. We should be reading the society, and we should grow organically, and we should we should have rectitude of conduct, we should be transparent, we should be trustworthy, and we should also trust people. And team building is very important. If you build a team and you trust them and you learn to delegate the authority, delegate the responsibility, and people take ownership. I think the success of Burley is the people who worked at Burley, they took the ownership. It was not my institute. I was a little part and person serving that little, that big institute.
You think it's possible to improve India from the ground up?
There is only one way, bottom up approach. Top down approach is not the sustainable. Bottom up approach, people's participation is the way.
Yeah, it's been really amazing.
And it has to be integrated and holistic approach. You cannot first work for polio, then you can't work for malaria, then you work for dengue, then you work for seeds, and one day you work for... It has to be holistic.
What is holistic for you?
Holistic is physical, mental, spiritual, social development of a human being. And integrating harmony among people, animal kingdom, vegetation kingdom, five elements.
Yeah, it's really amazing because the sustainable social structure that you've created is the one thing that's...
And also we should leave. We should prepare the second line. We should leave the place and go move forward.
What do you mean?
I created that institute, okay? After 26 years, I decided to leave. Succession plan. Hand it over to people and go.
Because otherwise you become too involved or...
It will not sustain. I fall, I die, institute will die. But it is sustaining because I left. And I consciously train people to run it. Same thing I'm doing now. I'm not making a foundation. I'm not making a trust. All these people I'm working with, I'm sure they will sustain whatever they think they should. I have to do my bit.
Are you optimistic about the future of India?
Of course. I'm optimistic for the whole world. We people who are working for sustainable development will establish the new world order, which will bring peace in the whole world. Okay. Thank you.
तो आप लोगों का क्या हुआ अभी क्या करते हैं बोलिए
तो सब लोग जा रहे हैं तो आपको बात करनी थी
चलो ड्राइव का क्या हुआ
बस मैं वही बीच से बात कर रहे थे तो उनको चाहिए